Okay, hello, my name is Michael Downey, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you all to the sixth AWRI webinar for this year's program. This week's session takes a look at vine balance and its effects on fruit composition. Yes, so before I jump over to our speaker, some very quick reminders for the audience. To provide a comment or to ask a question, please open the Q&A section of the webinar, type in your question and click to send it through. If you'd like to get involved through Twitter, please use the Twitter handle at the underscore AWRI. Also, this webinar is being recorded and it will be available to view later this afternoon from the AWRI's YouTube channel. All registrants will receive a link to view this recording after the session. Now, I'd also like to thank and acknowledge Wine Australia for providing funding and support for AWRI webinars. For those of you that have just joined us, welcome. Today's topic is targeted manipulation of vine balance. Does vine balance directly affect fruit composition? And it's a great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Everard Edwards. Everard has been with CSIRO since 2006, applying a background in whole plant physiology to wine grape management projects, including the impact of deficit irrigation, the interaction between temperature and water status during heat waves, the role of rootstocks in driving water use efficiency, and vine balance. It's fantastic to have Everard here today to share some insights. And I'll hand over now to Everard to make a start.
Okay, thank you. So basically what I'm talking about today is some research that was funded by Wine Australia and was a collaborative project between ourselves at CSIRO and the National Wine, Grape and Industry Centre over at Wagga Wagga. And we had quite a few people involved all in all, most of whom you can see their names on the slide there. So the origin of the work was growers questioning to Wine Australia, really wanting sort of vine balance and the link between crop load and fruit quality to be readdressed. And so we were asked to look at that. So in terms of what is vine balance, it gives you a difficulty to start with because really there's no accepted definition of what a vine balance is. And you can even search online and come up with recursive definitions such as vine balance is the state at which vegetative and reproductive growth lead to a balanced vine, which I don't think is particularly helpful for a grower. To sort of generate what that balanced vine is. However, if you talk to growers or winemakers or other people in the industry about what their conception of vine balance is, normally that discussion will focus around the relationship between the some measure of vigour of the vine and the yield or the fruit load on that vine. So in essence, when we ask what vine balance is, it's what in plant science we would call a source-sink relationship. So by that, and the reason that we are considering the vigour of the vine is the source here is the total photosynthesis occurring during the growing season. So that's the amount of carbon the vine fixes from the atmosphere and turns into sugar for growth and fruit ripening and so on. And basically that's a function of the size of the canopy, how much sunlight the vine receives, the nutrition of the vine, the water status, the temperature and so on, all of those things. When we think about the sink, there's a number of sinks in the vine, such as growth and the fruit and so on. So the one we're interested here obviously is the fruit itself, the ripening of that fruit. So that is a sink for the carbon that is produced from photosynthesis. And so we get this source sink relationship. In terms of the scale of fruit ripening as the size of their sink, if we think of a vine maybe with 10 kilograms of fruit at harvest, we're going to have, you know, almost 2.5 kilograms of sugar in that fruit. And 80% of that sugar will have been exported into that fruit just in those few weeks between veraison and harvest. So it's a large amount of sugar that's got to be fixed and utilized by the plant. So as you might imagine, to measure or estimate photosynthesis for an entire season for a vine or a vineyard is relatively difficult. It's not straightforward. But if we think about those factors that are driving that whole vine photosynthesis, you know, we've only got a fairly limited ability to control the sunlight and the weather and so on that's hitting that canopy. So really the simplest way that we can consider how much photosynthesis is occurring is to just look at the vine size itself. So the amount of leaf area there is to intercept light. And that's the biggest driver that we can control. You may have come across the Ravaz index, which is looking at the relationship between yield and pruning weight. That's not bad. Pruning weight is very strongly related to the canopy size, but it's a nonlinear relationship, which means that pruning weight can, as pruning weight gets bigger, the change in canopy size is less. And also it can vary from season to season. So it's quite difficult to use that as a measure to compare across seasons. So quite simply, for the work that we've been doing and for the purposes of this talk, we're going to define vine balance as the ratio between the yield at harvest and the size of the canopy, because we can measure that reasonably straightforwardly. So if that's our definition of vine balance, at least for today, why are we interested in vine balance? And really there's two reasons that people will come up with. One is to get to be able to achieve a certain sugar ripeness for winemaking. And the concern about this obviously depends in the region that you're in and the extent to which you have difficulty getting your fruit ripe. And the second one, and the one we're mainly going to talk about today and the one the project was set up to address, is achieving a desired quality. So can we use vine balance to get a specific quality in our fruit? So to briefly look at sugar ripeness, as you would no doubt well aware, if you've got a very high fruit canopy ratio, you're going to get a longer or require a longer maturation period. And that's because if we think about, you know, that canopy size, the amount of photosynthesis per unit of leaf to produce enough sugar to ripen a large crop, if the leaf area is the same, then clearly it needs more time to be able to generate that sugar through photosynthesis. Conversely, if we've got a low fruit load to canopy ratio, then, you know, we need less time to generate enough photosynthesis to make the sugar to ripen that fruit. So I think, you know, this is quite specific to region you're in, to the vineyard, to the aims of the grower, the winemaker, and so on. And really the tools are there for the grower to get that right, to get that correct, at least in most seasons when extremes don't occur. So this is not the area that we were really wanting to address in this work. The area that we were wanting to address is the link between vine balance and fruit quality or fruit composition. So this figure that you can see here is really just a model figure to indicate the way that people perceive that link between vine balance and fruit quality. So where we've got a low amount of fruit for the canopy size, you know, you might expect that you're getting fruit that is too ripe or it's difficult to harvest prior to it getting overripe. And so you've actually got a degradation in quality. And conversely, where we've got a high amount of crop per unit of canopy size, you know, we might struggle to get that ripe or to get the characteristics that we want. So it's somewhere in the middle that we think we get the best fruit quality, and therefore, you know, we're looking for that specific vine balance. So how do we actually look at and determine that relationship? And is that graph that I've just put up there, does that represent reality? So the way that we did it was that we wanted to look at a a variety of vineyards and basically apply the same techniques to all of those vineyards, and then look at whether we got different responses or whether we got the same response to our management techniques. So we picked vineyards in three different regions, three states, Langhorne Creek in South Australia, Murray Valley in Victoria, and Hilltops in New South Wales. All three of the vineyards were commercially managed. They were all growing Shiraz. They were basically all spur pruned. They all had Australian sprawl canopy. And we tracked them for three seasons, one after the other, to look for consistency in our results. So obviously those three sites will vary somewhat in climate. Hilltops was coolest in spring and autumn, but actually not the coolest in the summer, at least in terms of the mean monthly temperature. And you can see the mean January temperature there. On the other hand, Langhorne Creek, although it has has hotter days than Hilltops through the summer, because it's got cooler nights, when we look at this mean monthly temperature, it actually comes out cooler than the Hilltops, the high altitude Hilltop site. But really this is because we have difference in day to night temperature. So I think the mean monthly temperature is never going to tell us everything about a climate for sure. As you might expect, the Murray Valley site was the warmest throughout the season as a whole, had the hottest days and so on. In terms of rainfall, the Hilltops had the most rain, followed by Murray Valley and Langhorne Creek the driest. And so the irrigation that was applied to some extent reflected that, but also the difference in the size of these vines, which I'll show in just a moment. So it looks like Murray Valley's got much more water relative to the reference evaporation, but they're larger vines, so more water is required. So if we considered a crop coefficient for each of these vineyards, the relationship between the evapotranspiration and the water provided would be much closer across the three. So how did the three sites differ in terms of the two components of our vine balance definition, which are canopy size and yield? If we look at canopy size, generally the smallest canopy was at the Hilltop site, with the biggest canopy at the Murray Valley site. Did vary a little bit depending on the season, and in that final season we've got fairly high vigour in all three sites, so large canopies there. So we have both the site and season variation in canopy size. And of course, this is basically what we were looking for and why we chose these sites. The same is true of yield. So again, we've got a seasonal variation and we've got a big variation between the sites, with the first season at Hilltops extremely low yield, and the second season at Murray Valley extremely high yield. So again, you know, this is what we want. We want as much variation as we could so that we can try and determine whether there's any consistent effects in this relationship, this vine balance relationship. So this data on the figure here is just for the control. So this has not been manipulated in terms of the management of these vines at all by ourselves. So if we then calculate out the vine balance, again, this is the vine balance that the grower is imposing on the site. We can see at Langhorne Creek, despite the seasonal variation, the crop load and the canopy size were very well matched, and so the vine balance was almost identical across the three seasons. At the other two sites, we've got a very high yield relative to canopy size in the second season, so we've got quite a big seasonal variation in vine balance there. And at Hilltops, you know, it's different in all three seasons. So over the top of this, what we did was we imposed three additional management strategies on top of the one imposed by the grower, and we matched those. So we did the same thing at all three sites. And I'll just go through those one by one. So firstly, we did a crop removal treatment. Now, I think crop removal is probably the most common way that a grower may manipulate vine balance, particularly within a season. So we did this relatively early. We did it prior to veraison. So our crop removal is not removal of bunches with high heterogeneity. We're not looking for bunches with a lot of green grapes during veraison or anything like this. They're taken off basically at random, and we removed half of the bunches from the vines that were there. So it was quite a significant crop removal. And we did that the same way, all three sites. So we would expect that to have an impact on vine balance because we've taken off half of the bunches, and any compensation in terms of berry size is very unlikely to fully compensate for that amount of crop removal. So what I've done here is I've looked at the average impact of the treatment, so the average effect on vine balance across the all three seasons. And within each season, to make it easier to compare, because we've, you know, purposefully we've got sites that vary in vine balance, and we've also got vine balance differences season to season. So I've normalized this. So basically we're looking at the effect of the treatment relative to the control at each site. So the control, which is marked as T1 in blue here, will always be one because we've adjusted everything to be relative to that control. So as we might expect, when we take off bunches, we end up with a yield per unit of canopy area that's quite significantly reduced relative to the control. And that's what we were looking for to do. And it was successful at all three sites. Again, from what you would understand anyway, and what I mentioned earlier on, we would expect that if we do this, that the maturation period should be reduced. And that again was the case. So what I've graphed here is how many days ahead of control the harvest was. And the harvest occurred for all treatments when they reached 24 degrees Brix, so a common sugar level. Now, we weren't measuring maturation period precisely, so I don't have a measure from 50% veraison, say, through to exactly 24 Brix. And at hilltops, it appears that the effect on maturation period was lower. But what we found at hilltops was maturation was very quick. And so sometimes we were unable to get every harvest all of the vines exactly where we wanted them in terms of sugar. So that impact there is probably underestimated slightly. But basically, as we would expect, we've reduced the maturation period by the crop removal impact on vine balance. So the second treatment that we applied then was a late defoliation or severe summer pruning. And this was done at just prior to veraison as well, at EL32 stage at the same time as the crop removal. We aimed here to take off about half of the canopy, but we're leaving the fruit alone. So again, as we would expect, in this case, we've increased the amount of fruit per unit canopy size. So we've increased vine balance, and we can see that that was achieved across the three sites and seasons. It's slightly less at Murray Valley because this was double cordon vine, and it was very difficult to take as much canopy off without impacting the fruiting zone. So we would expect that we have the converse in terms of the maturation period. We've reduced the amount of canopy per unit fruit, so therefore we have a longer maturation period, and indeed that was true across the sites and seasons. So then the third treatment that we imposed was an early defoliation treatment. So this one is a little bit different, and it comes from work that's been done over in Italy, where prior to capfall, all of the leaves, all of the mature leaves are removed from the vine. And the idea is that it reduces the amount of sugar and carbohydrate available to those flowers, and therefore it reduces fruit set. But the canopy then refills through lateral growth of laterals, and so you end up with a similar size canopy but a reduced fruit set. So we were anticipating that this treatment basically would match the crop removal with similar canopy size but less fruit. In fact, when we look at the vine balance value, it didn't turn out that way. So what happened in our systems here in Australia with Australian sprawl rather than a highly managed VSP that they were using in Italy for this work, is that we had really very little effect on vine balance. So we reduced the crop load a little bit and we reduced the canopy size a bit as well. And so that gave us no consistent or statistically significant impact on vine balance. So in actual fact, what we have is a comparison of a treatment that's changed the size and structure of the vines relative to the growers' management, but without impacting vine balance at all. So we can compare between the controls and this this early defoliation treatment. So again, it had no consistent impact on the maturation period either. We do seem to have a small reduction in maturation period at Murray Valley, but potentially that's a bit of an artifact because it was difficult to apply that treatment well at Murray Valley. So to summarize this experimental system really, which is where we're at and what we've done, we applied these three management treatments across the three sites over and above the growers' standard management at that site, which clearly varied in itself. The early defoliation treatment we did, that reduced both yield and canopy, but gave minimal effect on vine balance itself. The crop removal treatment we did reduced yield with no effect on canopy, therefore we have a reduction in our vine balance calculation. The late defoliation treatment we did had no impact on yield, but reduced the canopy, so therefore we increased our vine balance canopy, vine balance calculation. Overall, across these treatments, where vine balance was higher, we lengthened maturation, and where it was lower, we shortened maturation. So the effects were similar across the three field sites, even though we had these different climates and different overall yields and slight differences in management between those sites, and they were similar across the three seasons. So we were successful in generating this system where we've got a lot of variation, but we can apply management techniques and get the same outcome in terms of vine balance manipulation. So as I said at the beginning, what we're really interested here is when we manipulate vine balance in this targeted way, what is the impact on the fruit composition, on the fruit qualities for winemaking? So what I have here is a graph. Again, it's averaged across three seasons for each of these treatments at each of the sites. And this is the total anthocyanins in the fruit at harvest. And as I said, they were all the treatments we attempted to harvest at the same sugar level at 24 bricks. So relative to the controls, we can see that we've maybe got a very small increase in colour with the early defoliation at two of the three sites, bearing in mind that Murray Valley, we only had a really good application of that early defoliation in one of the 3 years. When we look at the crop removal, and let's not forget, we took off 50% of the bunches here. We have exactly the same fruit anthocyanin concentration as the controls. We've had no impact on that fruit colour whatsoever. Then when we look at the late defoliation, and again, bearing in mind here that we've actually extended the maturation period, and with the shortening maturation due to warming and climate change, people around the world are looking for ways of extending the maturation period. And in several countries in Europe, this severe summer pruning of canopy is being used to try and generate that more extended maturation period. When we've done that consistently across these three sites and seasons, we've ended up with a reduction in the anthocyanin content of the fruit. So we've got lower color, which clearly is not a positive outcome in terms of winemaking. So the other sort of major fruit component we looked at was the tannins. This was somewhat more variable across both sites and seasons. Here, interestingly, that early defoliation at all three sites and across most of the seasons, we tend to get an increase in tannins of the fruit. And this may well be because a lot of those tannins are laid down very early in the season and they're responsive to sunlight. And that, of course, is when we've removed the leaves, and so that post-fruit set, those fruitlets are getting a greater exposure to light, and that may be driving this change in tannins. So that's to do with the structure of the canopy rather than the relationship between canopy and crop load. Again, we've certainly got no beneficial effect of either the crop removal or of the severe summer pruning, the late defoliation. So if I take the entire data set, in this case, the anthocyanins, and I look at the anthocyanins in the fruit for each season and each site and each treatment, and plot all of those against our calculation of vine balance, this is the figure that we get. Now, on this figure, I've also plotted out one of the main published estimates of an ideal vine balance for ripening sprawl canopy crops by Clue and DeKuzlian over in the US a few years ago. And you can see that marked on the figure here in that pinkish background color. So when we look at the entire data set, despite everything I've just told you, it does appear that we've got quite a strong relationship between the anthocyanins in the fruit at harvest and the vine balance. However, as I say, this is the total data set, all three seasons, all three sites. If we start to break that down, first of all, if we look at the three sites, we can see that the vast majority of that relationship is driven by a site-to-site difference. So it's a regional difference. So we've got a different vine balance in each of the three different regions, and we have a different fruit color in each of the three regions. So to be useful, wherever you're growing your grapes, if you want to manipulate vine balance to alter fruit composition, you need to be able to do it within your vineyard. Moving your vineyard to a totally different region and growing your vines in a different way is not really a useful answer. So if we look, you know, within each region at this relationship between color and vine balance, so at Langhorne Creek, you can see really there's little, if any, relationship there. At Hilltops, there does appear to be a bit more of a relationship, but in this case, if we look at the seasons, we can see that basically all of that range in, most of that range in anthocyanin was within the first 2014 season, and there's really no difference in vine balance that was driving that. So again, you've got to deal with your vines within any given season, and you've got to have confidence that any manipulation you do of vine balance within that season is actually going to have an impact on the fruit composition. And we don't really seem to be seeing that. Over at Murray Valley, you know, we don't even see any relationship again between color and vine balance across the data set as a whole. And if we look at the seasons individually, it's basically true again. So the manipulations we did within a season have not driven, we've driven differences in color, but we've not driven differences in color based on vine balance. So to sort of summarize this relationship between vine balance and color, the end result that you want as a grower is to have an improvement in whatever quality parameter you have. And the most common one to be paid on by industry is the amount of anthocyanin in the fruit. You want improvement of that at a given sugar concentration. So if we look at the amount of color in the fruit per unit sugar, in that fruit, because as I said, harvest is never perfect. And again, this is normalized, averaged across the three seasons and normalized to the grower's own control so that we can look for any consistent effect. We can see that the only one with a positive effect is this early defoliation, where we have an improvement in color, not large, but we do have an improvement in color per unit of sugar in that fruit at harvest. And this was the one treatment where we didn't affect vine balance. If we look at the crop removal, where we've taken off 50% of our bunches, and that means we've got a reduction in yield of maybe 40% plus, and so that's money we've taken off there. We've got no impact on fruit color whatsoever across those sites and seasons. And where we've done the severe summer pruning to delay maturation, which is an attractive proposition in itself, what we've got is a big reduction in color per unit sugar in the fruit. So one last aspect I want to talk about prior to finishing the talk was a different way we did of looking at this exact same question. So from all that field work we've done, we don't really see any relationship between vine balance and fruit composition per se. So we wanted to do this in a much more direct, scientifically controlled manner as well. And so what we wanted to do was to alter that photosynthesis I talked about at the beginning without affecting the bunch environment. So one of the things we've done with our treatments, whether it's that severe summer pruning where we've got more exposed bunches, or it's that early defoliation where we've got more exposed bunches just early in the season, is we've changed the bunch environment. And so that's probably driving the differences that we do see. So we developed a system where we basically could enclose mature vines in pots, and we could reduce the photosynthesis without impacting the bunch environment. And so we did that by changing the amount of CO2 in the air, which is what the vines are fixing through photosynthesis, and therefore reducing that sugar availability to ripen the crop. If you look on the left-hand figure here, this shows the increase in bricks of the fruit as they go through development in our potted vines here with our chambers. We've got the control ones under ambient CO2 marked in green. And then we also have vines where we've reduced the CO2 marked in white. And you can see we've changed the rate of sugar accumulation. So this is doing the same thing as crop taking leaves off the canopy, so our treatment for our late defoliation. So when we do that, we change the rate of maturation as we would expect. Now in this system, what we haven't done is affected the bunch environment. So when we look at the amount of sugar in that fruit, that very same fruit, the amount of color in that same fruit, and we plot that against the amount of sugar in those fruit, we can see that despite that big difference in maturation rate, and actually that difference in maturation rate is larger than we achieved in the field, we have exactly the same relationship between color and sugar. So by reducing the maturation rate, we didn't have any effect on the color of those fruit whatsoever. So to summarize the work as a whole, we really saw overall very little evidence to suggest that vine balance, defined here as the amount of fruit per unit area of canopy, had any impact on fruit composition per se, and particularly when we consider it within a given vineyard and within a given season. So the outcome of that, I would say, is that rather than concentrating on a certain amount of yield within a vineyard block, we're better off looking at the environment of the bunch in terms of driving a fruit composition and the structure of the canopy. So I think it's important to remember that the response we saw to our treatments, despite the fact we've got high altitude, cooler climate at hilltops, you know, versus hot climate, high production vineyard at Murray Valley, and then cooler evenings, warm days at Langhorne Creek, across all of that varied regional areas, when we imposed these treatments, these targeted managements of vine balance, we got the same result both on terms of the vine and on terms of the response of the fruit. So I think it gives us some faith that applying a certain technique or a change in canopy structure or a change in vine balance is going to do the same thing across most of our regions. So slowing maturation rate didn't benefit fruit quality in the field. In fact, it had a negative impact. And when we did it under those highly controlled conditions, we had no impact at all. And finally, I think it's interesting, this early defoliation that we did, which at the moment there isn't a practical way of doing that for most vineyards. We did it by hand and it was a lot of work. But that had an impact on the canopy structure that we saw, although we didn't formally assess that. And that was the one treatment where we'd got the shift in canopy structure where we did see changes in fruit composition, color, and tannins as a result. So I will just leave it there. And I would like to acknowledge, of course, Wine Australia for funding this work, but also very much the vineyard managers and the wine companies that we worked with to do the work, and the large number of technical staff that we had doing fortnightly sampling at all these three sites throughout the season, from flowering all the way through to fruit set. And I've only obviously just given the tip of the iceberg in terms of the data that we've got from this work. So gratefully acknowledge all of the help of these people. Thank you.
Okay, fantastic. Thanks very much, Everard. Very informative presentation there. We're going to move here straight into a Q&A. So if you've got any questions regarding the methodology or results regarding these trials, please send through your questions now. Just a reminder, if you do have a question, just open the Q&A part of the webinar toolbar and type to send your question in. So Everard, the first question we've got is, does colour provide the only measure of quality, and how does this correlate with flavour intensity or flavour complexity? I know you've got potentially a couple of slides and we can probably have a look at those if you're happy. I think we've got enough time to do that.
Okay. So of course, you know, colour is clearly just one aspect of fruit quality, and you know, colour in itself is not an impact on the flavour for sure, as we know. But I guess one reason for looking at colour is that it's one of the things which wineries pay on. So if you're being paid on a certain amount of colour or on exceeding a certain amount of colour, you know, then that's important. And so it's an aspect of quality. Tannins obviously are perceptible, and that's something as well that we looked at. Now, we did, of course, make wines from all of our fruit. We did that in all the treatments, all the seasons. And we did some wine difference testing. So I've just got a table here in terms of that difference testing, the outputs of that. So the most consistent effect in terms of the difference testing was, again, that T2, that early defoliation, where we saw two of the three sites, we got a statistically significant difference from the difference testing. So I guess one argument I would have is that if a consumer can't taste any difference between the wine, and I guess this is where the question is going, you know, is there any point in doing the work? So here we did generally see a detectable effect on the wine of this early defoliation. Interestingly, despite the big impact of the late defoliation on colour and the reduction in colour in the fruit and the wine, we didn't get any detectable difference from the consumers that were doing the tasting. Now, we could measure quite a few things that were different in those wines, but it didn't appear that the tasters were seeing those differences. We did also, interestingly, on one of the wines at one season at one site, we did get a small impact of the crop removal on the difference testing. And I don't have time to go into it, and it's not as clear as the fruit results anyway. But when we look at all of the wines and so on, whilst we generally see, you know, more tannins in the wines from fruit that had more tannins, and more colour in the wines from fruit that had more colour, and less colour in the wines from the fruit that had less colour, you know, that relationship between fruit and wine is not perfect, and it's, you know, it's not one to one.
Okay, thanks for going through those final slides there, Everard. Another question here from Warren. If we trim off the canopy at EL32, will this reduce the functionality of the retained leaves, resulting in reduced carbohydrate transfer into the bunches? This may explain the reduced colour and tannins in the grapes at harvest. Warren also says, if I recall correctly, leaves are only functional for about 100 days. That is a net, as a net exporter of carbohydrates.
According to this. Okay, that's a good question. So we basically consider the vine to have positive net photosynthesis from round about flowering. Prior to flowering, the vine's getting a lot of its carbohydrate from its reserves, both in the trunk and particularly, I think, in the primary roots. And our Australian vines, I think, tend to have quite high reserves because we have a lot of sunlight compared with much of Europe. And that's probably one reason why that early defoliation that we did didn't have a big impact on the fruit set compared with when they do it in Italy, basically because the vine has the reserves to drive that. So from about flowering, the canopy as a whole is a net producer of carbon, of photosynthate, and that will basically continue until those leaves senesce at the end of the season. So when we take off, say, half of those leaves at EL32, we did do some photosynthesis measurements actually directly in the field, and we certainly don't see a reduction in photosynthesis of the remaining leaves. Actually, what happens is there's a bit of compensation. So the remaining leaves actually increase their photosynthetic rate. So we tend to see overall that post-veraison, and it doesn't make a lot of, it's sort of counterintuitive, but post-veraison, the rate of photosynthesis in each leaf actually drops off as they head towards senescence later in the season. So that maturation period, not only are we trying to put that huge amount of sugar into the fruit, but we're also filling our reserves. And we're trying to do it when our canopy is actually has lower rates of photosynthesis than it does pre-veraison. But yeah, basically the remaining canopy actually is producing less photosynthesis overall, but the individual leaves are producing more than they would be if we hadn't removed some of the canopy. So there's a degree of compensation.
Okay, thank you for that. Another question here. For the seasonal variations of anthocyanin, did you correlate that to weather? Any correlation between sunny versus cloudy time or time of rain during the season?
Recorded all the weather at each of those three sites. We had a dedicated calibrated weather station at each site for this reason. Clearly there are temperature differences between the sites and the seasons, and that is definitely going to be one of the maybe not straightforward, but is, you know, the weather is certainly going to be one of the things that have impacted the seasonal differences there. Without putting all of that data back in front of me, whether it was the high light or high temperature years that drove higher or lower anthocyanin content, I wouldn't like to say. I'd have to go back and look at that. But, you know, all of that was recorded. So, yeah, we have that data at least.
Okay. Under the T2 treatment, what was the driver for the reduced yield? Was it reduced berry size, reduced berry number per bunch?
So again, my recollection without going back to the data is that primarily it was reduced berry number per bunch. We weren't affecting the bunch number. I think there wasn't a big difference in berry size. So at least in terms of a consistent compensation in berry size across the sites and seasons. So I think probably that reduction was primarily berry number. But again, I'd have to double check my data, but it is all in there, and it's in the final report, which is available from Wine Australia as well.
Thanks for your question there, Marty. And yeah, as Everard's just pointed out, it is available within that report, and I'll be circulating a link to that report with a follow-up email after this session. Another question here, Shiraz is known for berryvascular detachment, thus preventing additional reserves moving into the berry. Was this measured for the detachment date? And if not, was it considered?
It wasn't measured, no. So because we were basically applying our treatments pre-veraison, and that's occurring, you know, late on in the season, it was very long way. The treatments we put on were a very long way earlier than that would occur. It potentially has some impact on the fact, perhaps on that T4 treatment, the late defoliation where we've extended maturation period. So that may be one reason why we were, you know, struggling to get the colour and the sugar at the end of that season for sure. So the details may vary between varieties in terms of how big a negative effect doing that severe summer pruning is. So for instance, Cabernet may not be quite as bad. But really, I think the major impact on that fruit was that much greater light exposure that occurred from removing half those bunches. So you, in the hot seasons, we got, you know, more occurrence of sunburn and shrivel on that fruit, definitely.
Okay, great. Thank you, Everard, for going through those questions. Looks like that's going to be it for today's session. Everard, would you mind just switching to that final slide there? So I'd like to first extend a big thank you to Everard. Before I wrap up, sorry, we've just had a late question come through. I will give it to you, Everard. Do you think these results will be applicable to other red wines?
Yeah, basically, absolutely. I think they're applicable to the majority of regions and the majority of wine grapes, especially red wines, because what we're looking at is, you know, fundamental responses of the vine. And it was the reason why we tried to get a wide variation in terms of region, climate and production target, so that we were looking at something fundamental in the vine rather than just simply, this is what happens on this site in this season.
Okay, thanks for going through that final question there. And thanks, David, for sending it through. I'd also like to extend a thank you to the audience who's participated in today's session. All attendees will receive a follow-up email with a link to the recording of this webinar. The next AWRI webinar is on Thursday, 18th of October, with the Bureau of Meteorology's Vernon Carr providing an update on seasonal and probabilistic forecasting and a frost prediction for the season. If you'd like to register for this session, please visit the AWRI website. Thank you again for participating, and I look forward to seeing you again at the next AWRI webinar.